Welcome. This talk is about the Mega 65 project. And this is a new talk I just created 3 weeks ago, as I had a funny idea to go to such conventions and see if this is a great thing. And I can tell you I had lots of fun. Who am I? My name is Oliver Graf. I'm someone who started with a VIC-20, then moved over to a C128. I had slight contacts with Apple IIs in my school, doing UCSD Pascal and other funny things like Mandelbrot sets on 4-color needle printers or something like that. As I moved on to a PC, I quickly discovered that Windows is not my thing, so Linux it was. And in my work life, I'm a network architect and a software developer at a local little ISP in Rhineland-Palatinate. With the Mega 65 project, I'm associated since 2021. And I started looking back into retro computing and stumbled over projects like Commander X16 and Mega 65. And yeah, there also I started with a Mandelbrot set, and somehow I got sucked in to the project because I discovered a problem, and the reaction of the developers was, hey, try to fix it. Yeah, so I fixed it, and then I was suddenly part of the team. And since 2022, I like to call myself the GitHub janitor. I look after the repositories, I prepare for releases, and I also actively develop on the core and on infrastructure for the PC and for the Mega 65 itself. Yeah, what's the Mega 65? For that, we first take a little look back into history. So 1980, we had the VIC-20, as we all know. 1982, the Commodore 64 followed. And 1985, so short time periods, we had the Commodore 128. Then around 1986, 87, you all know what Commodore did? They bought Amiga and brought out the first Amiga. And a bit later, 1991, they suddenly decided, hey, let's do another 8-bit platform. And the names that were in fluctuation were C65 or also C64DX. So the not classic design with a front-loading floppy drive and a 3.5-inch floppy drive, which you did not see in the old Commodore computers. They always had the 1541 or 1571, the 5 1/4-inch disks. Yeah, they developed the system, they developed new chips. It had a Plitter-like chip, a DMA magic chip, they called it. It had a new VIC chip. It had the same old SID chip. And it had a new CPU, the 4510. And this one don't had any undefined opcodes as the 6502 had. Yeah, so then features got tested, ROM got developed, and people were set up on the task to determine how compatible the C65, which had a C64 mode, is to the C64, because the C64, there is this huge software library. So you want to have this software library for your new 8-bit machine. And the testers were not happy with the system. It was not very compatible. You didn't have the 5 1/4-inch floppy drive directly there. You had to buy another drive, and those drives were very expensive because they had a whole CPU inside, as we all know. And that was one of the reasons it did not bode well for the testers. And also those pesky opcodes, the undocumented opcodes, they did not work. So most of the very old software that made use of them did not work. And other features also did not quite sync up with the C64 software library. So because of that, and perhaps also of because of financial reasons, they terminated the project. And to that time, we don't know exactly, around 200 systems, we think, were in fluctuation with different hardware revisions, and they got sold off or thrown away for little money, and the development was completely halted. And more Amigas were made, obviously. You can buy those systems. I think I talked today with a few people who actually have one, with one who has one. And I also know people who have one. If you look for eBay auctions or look on the wiki page of the C65, you can find that it is sold for prices up to 20,000, 30,000 euros because it's so rare. If it is worth it, I don't know. But in the end, this was the reason why different people decided, hey, the C65 would be interesting. Perhaps we can recreate it. And one of those people was Paul Stephen Gardner from Australia. And the other folks were MEGA, the non-profit club, so in German, Verein, which I'm a member of, decided, let's proceed, look at this, and let's develop C64 in some way. And the first designs in VHDL and Verilog, certain parts are Verilog, were made on a Nexus 4 DDR development board, which has an Arctic 7 100T FPGA. So it's a pure FPGA development board, no modern CPU on it. And you can see there are lots of cables connected, and the board is actually in a C65 case. With the cables, the original keyboard was connected. Yeah, and then the work began to implement all those chips that were documented. There were technical documentations, there were diagrams of the system, and from that we recreated those electronics in the FPGA. After the designs looked good, the first real or the first custom PCB was made. With this, we now had the interfaces the system should have. So on the Nexus board, you only have modern interfaces, USB and such things. And here we then added the expansion board, the joystick ports, a VGA, HDMI is not very old, but we decided we need one for better, so that more people can use it. Not everyone has an old monitor. We have an IEC interface, and this one on the side is the floppy interface, because the drive in the C65 had its own chip for controlling the floppy drive. And this was not compatible with the way Commodore did its other drives. So, it had to be done in an extra way. So this is why it's not some internal IEC bus. After the first revision of the board, which had about I think it was 3 or 4 PCBs were made in total. A better design was made, more parts were added that we found out we needed for a full system. We have some extra connectors, groove connectors, we have extra breakouts for the FPGA. This board had around 25 produced units, and they are still in use for dev kits we lent out to developers who are interested in developing for the Mega 65. So to push the software development of real Mega 65 software and not have to use C65 software, because there was not really C65 software in the past. The system was not released, so we needed to create some software we can use. The third revision of the board, this is the one that actually got produced in big numbers. We had a development kit with this board, and also the produced units that are now in the field are also with this board. The board has a much better digital audio output. It has very many small corrections. We found out the R2 board was bad in some way. We opted for raising the size of the flash chip that is on the board. So as this is a pure FPGA board, we need some place where the bitstream, so to say the configuration of the FPGA, where the logic that is put into the chip is described. This needs to be in some flash chip. The FPGA will scan automatically. And this we made bigger because we thought it would be nice to have more place for putting in more cores, because we thought, hey, perhaps people might make other cores than the Mega 65 in some time. Yeah, we did not have the case yet. Because the case, you can see at the booth, is an injection molded case, and such an injection molded case is very pricey to produce, because you need to build a tooling to make this injection mold, and it was around 70,000 euros. And for being able to create this as a non-profit organization, we did searching for English words, spenden, donations. Yeah, thank you. We made a donation drive for the tooling, and it went faster than we thought, actually, because people donated crazy amounts. So, but we did not have the case yet. We only had test cases. So the first 100 dev kits, we called them, had a plexiglass acrylic case with the real keyboard and all the real electronics and a floppy drive. In this case, the floppy drive goes out to the side. Some people ask for that very much. Yeah. But the real case is the real thing, so it goes out to the front. We had produced 100 of those, and they had a very high price point of 999 euros. And they were also meant to get in developers. Yeah, perhaps we should not have written limited edition on it. So a lot of them are in displays and not used at all. We know that for the future. As I said, the donation drive went well. It gathered around 30,000 euros in the first 2 months, and got slower and slower and slower. And people got worried, oh, it will take till 2030. But then one guy donated 40,000 euros, and we were over the limit. So many thanks to him. He really wanted the case. Yeah, but we also wanted the case. And it's very beautiful. You have to look at it and touch it in reality. It also has a very nice keyboard, which is a Cherry MX mechanical keyboard made by GMK. The case is made by Hirtsteiner in Österreich, Austria, sorry. And the electronics inside are made by Trans Electronics, which is also a German company. So all the parts are made in Germany. Okay, chips are imported, for sure. But that's also a bit of... we didn't want to make it in China. We wanted to make it in European countries. And we didn't want to use Kickstarter. We wanted a normal ordering process and no confusion about do I get what I pay for or don't I get it? Yeah. What can I point out? Yeah, the whole platform, I like to call it, consists of many parts. One part we see, which is the case, the keyboard, and the FPGA mainboard. Then we have the FPGA core of the Mega 65, which implements the chips, the electronics inside the FPGA. And then we have another part, which is the ROM. The ROM is also based on the original ROM Commodore developed for the C65. We based it on the original sources and developed it so that it got to production level. The thing is, you can exchange parts. So you can, it's an FPGA, you can run other different cores on the system. You can also use different ROMs. You don't need to use the original ROM. There's an open ROM. The open ROM also runs on the Mega 65. Open ROM also runs, I think, on C64. I'm not sure. The problem with the sources of the original ROM is Cloanto has the rights for the ROM. At least they told us so. And because of this, we can't give put out the ROMs for anyone. We only can put out patches for the ROM. And only users that have a Mega 65 get a key so that they can download the full ROMs and that they can access our GitHub repositories of the ROM. Which brings me to the next point, which is GitHub, because the whole Mega 65 project is open source. All parts of it are on GitHub, with the exception of the closed ROM, because we need to do so. Cloanto told us. The diffs of the ROM are based on a ROM Cloanto provides for free with the C64 Forever package. So in the C64 Forever package, look in the ROMs folder, you will find some C65 ROMs there. And yeah, with that, we are in the clear with the patches. There are many parts of the project. All those I explained, we have the core, which is the FPGA configuration, recreating the electronics. We have the Mega 65 tools, which are tools for your PC. We support all major three platforms to communicate with your Mega 65. And we have the user guide, which is a manual for the Mega 65. And it is in the package you get when you buy a Mega 65, 240 pages, ring-bound, manual, as in the old days. You can lay it flat on your table. You have all the basic commands explained. Okay, one terabyte, the manual is from 2021. And it is, yeah, it's changed in the past. But we need to print new manuals, so the next batch part of it will get new manuals. But the whole manual is not 240 pages. The whole manual is around 1,300, 1,400 pages. You have the whole documentation. You have the CPU modes documented, all the registers of the chips. And there's a lot. And it's not done yet. So we still are working on this. We have volunteers that do spell checking, or replacing all occurrences with of kernel with kernel, or kernel with kernel. It shifts sometimes, what's the right word. And there are many parts. We also welcome contribution. So if you are happy to help, and there's also an emulator of the Mega 65. You don't need actually hardware. Then there is a lot to do. and everything is community-based. So the hardware is done by real companies that do this for a living, but the software that runs on the system is done by the open source project. And another part that the project attracted somehow is this. Two developers began exploring the platform. They also had the development system, and they started porting Mister cores. Mister is a different FPGA-based platform. It's a bit different than the Mega 65 because the Mister not only has an FPGA, it also has an ARM dual-core CPU on it. So the Mega 65 don't have any CPU, except if you put a CPU in the FPGA. And it uses the ARM CPU for stuff like on-screen display and SD card access and USB devices. So it's not so easy to take the CPU implementations of some system that is made for the Mister and plug it into the Mega 65. So over the course of three different cores, which was a Game Boy Color, ZX Uno, which is a ZX Spectrum core, and the C64 core of the Mister project, they developed a Mister to Mega 65 framework, which I call a HAL, so a hardware abstraction layer. And this framework provides abstraction of the hardware of the Mega 65, so all the ports you have. And it provides a 16-bit QNICE CPU, which is a CPU that somebody developed. I can't remember the name. And this does the menus and the on-screen displays you normally have on the Mister. And with this, it was possible to accelerate the development of cores. You can use the framework to develop new cores, to have all the peripherals already done in VHDL, and can concentrate on the CPUs and graphic chips you need. And you can rapidly port Mister cores to the Mega 65. So currently, this happens mostly with arcade cores. It's not so the thing I really like to see, but it's nice to have as a proof of concept, essentially. So a Galaga core was essentially ported in a few weeks, and then you could play Galaga on the Mega 65. And for me, that was an indicator that the framework is well designed and can be easily used by someone who has knowledge of VHDL and electronic design. Yeah, about software, there are already software releases for the Mega 65. Okay, not the big library of the C64, but we have an arcade shooter-like game and an Infocom adventure, Hibernated, which are released as real boxed games by Polyplay, and there's a new game in development. You can play it at my booth. It's not quite done, but it displays some of the graphical features we put in the WIG4 graphics chip. And yeah, there are development tools you can use to communicate with the Mega 65. You have ways to directly put software from your PC if you cross-develop on the Mega 65. And you can also develop software directly on the Mega 65. There's, for example, one project that is called 11. It is a IDE for the Mega 65, a basic IDE, but the Mega 65 ROM already has basic. Yeah, but it is a basic that don't have line numbers, but labels. And it can use long variable names and has some pre-processing stuff going on. And the way it works is if you compile the program, it does not create some P code or assembly. It creates a basic 65 program from the source. And while you're doing that and testing your program, you can always jump back into the development environment on your Mega 65. You can do the whole development there. So there are both ways available. On the PC side, LLVM MOS was recently expanded with support for the Mega 65 CPU opcodes. So now you can use Rust to develop for the Mega 65 natively, which is interesting. I'm not sort of a Rust fan. Yeah, and we don't stop where we were. We develop on, and this is the future. This is the next board. This is an R4 board. There's the small 4, but it's all already old. I hope in a few weeks we have the R5 board. So why do we have a new board revision? I could say Commodore also put out new board revisions every year, so why shouldn't we? That's in the style of Commodore. No, the board had some problems we found out, and users found out. For example, the HDMI port of the R3 board had a HDMI backpower problem. We are in good company there. I think the Spectrum Next first revision also had HDMI backpower problems. So essentially, power from the monitor flows into the FPGA and does weird stuff with it sometimes. So on the new board, there's protection for that. Then we have new hardware for the digital audio again. There are some nice ESD cages on some chips, but we only need one of them. We had huge problems with our RTC, our real-time clock, in the R3 boards. There we got, during the chip crisis, we got a bad batch of RTCs, and there was no way of finding this out before creating the board, making the boards. And yeah, about 20% of them just don't click, tick. There's a workaround with external clock through, and there's also a program where you can request external clock from us if you have a broken RTC. So on this new board, we decided to go full way and put on a Swiss RTC. So this should really tick, I think. And there's a super cap which holds power for the RTC if you decide to change the battery. And we are not associated with Edeka. I just bought the power cell there. What is also changed on the R5 board? The R5 board has on the expansion port and on the joystick ports, we have pins that are not bidirectional, and they were bidirectional on original C64. So this is a thing we also fixed in this revision. And the last big thing is the old boards all had 8 megabytes of hyper RAM, which is serially connected. Sounds a lot, but yeah. The system has memory in the FPGA. This memory is very fast because it's directly in the FPGA. The hyper-RAM is with one serial line, or two lines essentially, connected. Or are it four? Not many lines. And it is slow. And it has lots of latency. And the developers of the Mr. 2 Mega 65 framework told us they can't do the big cores with that setup. They made experiments, they worked with buffering, and all of it did not really had the results they hoped for. So we couldn't know that before, and we didn't plan for, we need 64 megabytes of RAM. For what? We only want to make a C65. Yeah, but they wanted more memory, so we heard their call, and we added 64 megabytes of SD RAM, which is parallelly connected to the FPGA, and which is really fast. So we already could test this on the R4 board. The R5 board has a few minor revisions to that, and every unit which will ship out from now will have this new board as soon as we have finalized it. So first we need to get it, we need to make a core for it, and then we tell Trends which does the boards. Now you can do the huge numbers. We hope the next batch is also around 500 units. We will see. Yeah. That's it already. Questions? What's the price? Okay. So the price is €666.66 without VAT. Taxes. It's taxes, right? Yeah. So if you buy it in Germany, it's 740 or something like that. Yeah. And it's, as I said, it's no Kickstarter. Trends is a company which works business to business. So they produce FPGA PCBs for industrial stuff. And normally they don't do stuff for consumers. This is a special relationship we have with them. They are also Commodore fans and they like the project, so that is why we are working with them. And yeah, they are really a great help. They provide lots of knowledge about PCB design. They also did a great work connecting all those lines from the SDRAM. Yeah. More questions?
When will the next batch actually be delivered? Everybody wants to know.
I waited for that one. So currently, as I said, R5 board is, I looked at the mails last evening. They are finalizing the last changes, something about buffers, and I don't know. I don't know all this electronic stuff. So then if that is finished, and it should be next week, then next week, new boards, test boards, 10 pieces will be ordered. It will take about 5 weeks until we get them. Then we need to test them. This should be finished quite fast because we already have the R4 core and the R5 board is only fixes and slight changes. So we should be able to test its functionality directly, and then we can give the go to Trends to order the full batch of boards. I think it's 500, and then you need to add another 5 weeks, and then they have the PCBs, then they need to put on the parts. So it's next year, definitely. It won't be Christmas, I don't think so. So Christmas was somehow a wish of many people, and some people wanted to step the extra step of checking the R5 board, but I think that would have been a bad decision. We need to make sure that the new board works as it should, and yeah, we can't afford to just order 500 pieces and then throw them into the garbage. That does not work. There's not enough money to do that. there are not big margins we can work with. Yeah. More questions?
So it's the first time I heard about this project and this computer. And do you have any idea why Commodore tried to make a successor for the C64 in 1991? So it looks really weird for me.
Yeah, I had also had discussions today with a few people about this. There could be many ideas. So one idea is the huge software library of the C64. Then there was also the, what was this, Apple II GS, which came out around the same time, someone mentioned to me. And this was also expanded Apple II. So perhaps this was a driver at Commodore. Someone saw it and thought, oh, they bring out another 8-bit. Perhaps we should too. I don't know. It's all wild guessing for me. Yeah, I don't know. The software library, I guess that's the huge thing. But because at the start of the Amiga time, there was not much software for it, I think. And perhaps someone thought, yeah, let's do it and make another machine that can use it. But they failed in that. More questions? No, sieht nicht so aus.
Sounds like an out.
Okay, then, if you want to take a look, touch the keys, type in some BASIC, come over to booth 21. It's ways through at a desk, at the entrance desk. Behind the entrance desk, that was what I wanted to say. And yeah, thank you very much for listening.